Hello, delighted to be with you. My name is Renata Sperandio. I'm the director of the Italian Cultural Institute in Dublin, and I'm speaking from the Italian Cultural Institute in Dublin. I am absolutely delighted that the Institute has been invited to take part in this initiative, ClassicsNow, initiated by Helen Mini, who told me about this initiative back in February or March, or even last year. But we had a meeting last March, and we talked about the possible, ideas for this wonderful program. Many ideas came up. Fortunately, at least one remained, and the one I really wanted to host here at the Italian Cultural Institute. It is a conversation about Greece, Greek, the language, the culture, the love for the language, and the attraction we all have for that culture. So it is really a pleasure to have a good friend of mine, Mary Norris, who was a copy editor at The New Yorker, who is the one and only comma queen, whose book, Between You and Me, Confessions of a Comma Queen, was in fact presented here at the Italian Cultural Institute a few years ago. She wrote also Greek to Me, a book we all enjoyed very much. And I'll leave it to Mary then to start a conversation with a person who wrote several very successful books about Greek. So her name is Andrea Marcolongo. Thank you very much, Andrea, for being with us. One of the books she wrote, La Lingua Geniale, Nove Ragioni per Amare il Greco, which was translated into the ingenious language, Nine Epic Reasons to Love Greek, and is available. And it is a journey into the language. And it is also a fairy tale of the beauty, about the beauty of this language. I confess, Andrea, that I almost cried. I was so moved by the chapter on the duel. I mean, it was really like a love story for me. So I leave it to you. It is really an honor and a pleasure to have you here. I'm most thankful to the initiative started by Helen. And I hope we can do several events, at least one more event live. And I hope it will be with you, Mary and Andrea, here in Dublin. I leave it to you for this conversation. And I know at the end there will be probably a conclusion by Helen, who will probably tell us about the other ideas that have come up in order to produce this series of events. So thank you again, and to you, over to you, Mary.
Okay. Thank you so much, Renata, and also Helen, for the invitation to come virtually to Dublin and speak with Andrea Marcolongo. Andrea, it is a pleasure to meet you at last, too. I noticed when I compared as a, I don't know, I guess I'm more studious than I think of myself as, but I did compare the Italian version of your book with the English. And one of the things that jumped out at me was that the English version had to contain a sidebar on Liceo Classico, because we don't understand the Italian school system at all here. So could we maybe begin by your explaining how you came to Greek through Liceo Classico?
Of course, Mary. But first of all, thank you once more. Thank you, Ellen, for organizing this festival that this year I think is really necessary during what I already experiencing all around the world. Thank you, Renata, and thank you, Mary, for let me explain this kind of mystery, because it's so strange or curious that almost only in Italy, students starting from the age of 14 are still today, nowadays, are still studying ancient Greek. Not even in Greece, there is something similar to the Liceo Classico. Well, the literature classico is one of the possible kind of lyceum, or we can say high schools. There is a scientific, literature scientific or scientific lyceum, and then there is the classical one, where at age, again, at 14 years old, sometimes 13, students are supposed and are supposed to study to have to nowadays it's something like 3 hours per week of Latin and 2 hours or 3 hours per week of Greek, ancient Greek, and of course not only the classical, the subject are not only Greek and Latin, but there is all the other subjects and Latin and Greek in these last 5 years. And it's quite hard. It's quite hard. It's really hard. It's really hard for me. I'm not joking. I'm really honest, Mary. Sometimes when I eat too much, now I don't want to talk about Italian kitchen, but when I eat too much or when I'm too tired, I still have nightmares about ancient Greek. Yesterday, I was giving an interview with an Italian journalist. We shared our memories about Liceo Classico. And really, my attitude now is still like, I still have 14 years old, and the Greek teacher is coming here to ask me ancient Greek verbs. So it's really challenging, and I always saying that the purpose of Liceo Classico is not only to learn Greek and Latin, but it's really like preparing a marathon. If you survive Liceo Classico, then anything else in life will seem easy.
Well, I had a completely different experience, because when I was growing up, it was just when the schools were starting to depart from the teaching of Latin. And I don't know any schools that taught Greek. And so I did not come to Greek until I was in my 30s. And when I had an opportunity to take Latin, when I was quite young, I went to a Catholic school, and the nuns were offering a Saturday class in Latin. And they handpicked students that they thought would be good at it. And I was chosen, but I asked my father, could I take this course? And he said, absolutely not. And I've been trying to interpret that for the rest of my life. But so I've never studied Latin. And as I say, I started Greek. I came to Greek through modern Greek because I wanted to travel in Greece. And it was while I was traveling in Greece that I thought, oh, I wonder if I could also learn ancient Greek so that I could read everything that the people who came before me on this Aegean Sea had read. And so when I came home, I started studying ancient Greek. And I do envy you the experience of getting it early, you know, when you were young. That seems, you know, I felt like I missed something. And I console myself by saying that, my life experience was something that I could bring to the study of Greek. And so it just hit me differently than it would have when I was 14. I do love the sidebars in your book. I know they're just side dishes and they're not the main course at all, but maybe we can talk a little about them later. In the one on Liceo Classico, though, you do mention Elena Ferrante and My Brilliant Friend. And that did make me wonder if the title of your book in Italian was at all influenced by the title of L'Amica Geniale.
Oh, but thank you for asking me this. But no, first of all, no, the title has nothing, it's not related to with the Elena Ferrante title. It was more related with the French Genial. That it's something like epic or cool, because in my mind it was, as in Italy, we suffered a lot, as Renata confirmed. At Liceo Classico, it was weird even to say Greek is something cool, it's nice, it's brilliant, it's amazing, but I think it's the kind of trauma for we we would survive the Liceo Classico. But going back to Elena Ferrante and this book, the story of Liceo Classico and in general of the role of ancient Greek in Italy, still today it's the same. It's more relating about education and politics and opportunities, especially for women. Because still when 30 years ago, when I was a child, but again, still today, Liceo Classico is often seen like the elite high school. I mean, there are really, really like a dynasty. There is the ancient Greek vocabulary in Italy. The most famous one is the Rocci. That it's like an heritage. The father after his education gave it to the son, and then it's like a family heritage. But this it's also created this kind of the bourgeois high school, also creating like a segregation and for students from families where any kind of education was not that common. And right. As it seemed like, as we can read it in Elena Ferrante Roman novels. Mm-hmm. And for me, it was quite the same because no one in my family had never studied. Not only, I'm not talking about ancient Greek, never. I grew up in a house in my house in Chianti near Florence, where not books, no one in my family read. So I was not supposed at all to go to high school, to Liceo Classico, studying ancient Greek. It was my teacher at the primary school that suggested my father to send me to Liceo Classico. And still, my father asked me, what is really exactly ancient Greek? Because for him, it was so strange, so weird, that for him, ancient Greek, it was like Egyptian or Arabic. He had no ideas. And so, yes.
Well, it's wonderful that your father was curious about it. And so you kind of, the roles were switched and you could educate him to some extent. Well, we have that in common too. We have backgrounds that were not like aristocratic learning families. My parents graduated from high school and then they were working class. But there are certain similarities in our books that really stood out to me. And one was that we both rely on Virginia Woolf at the beginning, that wonderful essay of Virginia Woolf's on not knowing Greek. In my case, because my father wouldn't let me study Latin, I assumed, without having read the essay, that Virginia Woolf's father had forbidden her to study Greek. And that was why she wrote an essay called On Not Knowing Greek. It's quite a different story then. And do you want to talk about how helpful that essay was to you in approaching your book?
Yes, I think that the idea of writing this book came from one of my students. When I graduated university, then I start teaching ancient Greek, and one guy, it was already 8-10 years ago, he asked me, but what does really Greek want to say to me? And that's why I wrote this book. At the beginning, we were just notes. But getting back to Virginia Woolf, her little essay gave me the strength to declare that maybe I have never understood Greek. I've studied Greek at least 10 years or more in my life, but I still, when I wrote my book, I still didn't have no idea of the real meaning of the aspect in ancient Greek. The dual for me, it was like, it was something mysterious more than aliens. And that's why I related to Virginia Woolf. But still now I'm not fully convinced, and I would like to ask you this, I'm still not fully convinced that we can, of course we can learn ancient Greek, but I'm not still fully confident we can understand ancient Greek.
Well, Virginia Woolf's point was largely that we didn't know what it sounded like. So, and it, you know, this is especially important in, well, it's important, period. But in a play, you know, how can we appreciate a play of Aeschylus when we don't know what it sounded like for Cassandra to utter her lines, oh, toi, which is, which, as Virginia Woolf said, was just a sound that expressed inexpressible grief. And, you know, it's a long ways from then to now to be able to comprehend that. But it struck me that what Virginia Woolf is talking about is that although we can't know, we don't know what it sounds like, there's a place that we reach when we study Greek where insight kicks in. And you really think you understand the character. And so you understand what she's trying to tell you. I think that's kind of how it worked for me. You have to bring your own humanity to it and trust that the Greeks were just as human as we were. Which kind of goes without saying, I guess. But people forget. They think that classics are not to be...
Yes.
You know, and that's one of the things I love about what you've done is that, well, did you teach in university or did you teach in Liceo Classico?
Liceo Classico.
Oh, you went back and taught in that.
Yes, but it was my turn to tutor students. And,
Well, what does ancient Greek sound like in Italian? The Greeks, modern Greeks, just pronounce it as if it were modern Greek. In English, there are these careful systems that scholars devised. Some of them are from internal clues in ancient Greek, but otherwise it seems to me quite artificial, something that they have laid on it and kind of stilted. But what do they do in Italian? I have no idea.
Me neither. No, I'm joking, but I have something very funny to share because really trauma and nightmares, but also passion, but now we are talking about nightmare. For me, the pronunciation and the rhythm of ancient Greek, the metric is still a big issue. But for me, ancient Greek and Italian sounds, yes, of course, we have the standard Italian pronunciation. It's not the Italian, the Latin standard to pronounce ancient Greek. That it's very, so we really follow the Erasmian.
Erasmus, that's right. He's the one.
Yeah, he is the one. I have to declare that I'm not that good at all with accent in ancient Greek. I still don't have sometimes, and not quite often, not only sometimes, I still have no idea where I have to put the accent in ancient Greek. But I think once when I was at high school, my teacher told me that we need to have to feel the rhythm, you know, like when you take dance classes. And I answer that I'm not good, I'm terrible at dancing, so I can't understand where I have to put the accent in ancient Greek. And the final trauma was last year or 2 years ago. Now I'm in Paris, I live in Paris. I gave a lecture at La Sorbonne and I start reading, I think it was Plato, I started reading in Greek. I was very, very proud of myself. When I realized that the audience was turning at me like I was completely fool or crazy. And I start trembling because I still have that high school reaction. When I realized and someone actually told me that the French pronunciation of ancient Greek is completely different from the Italian one. So for me, I don't know, it's a... Yeah, but we are very close to Virginia Woolf dilemma.
Well, I think it's fascinating that you have included in La Lingua Geniale a whole chapter devoted to diacritical marks, accents, and the breathing marks, all those things that are very much a part of your first year of ancient Greek. And modern Greek has evolved and just uses one tonal accent right now, which I personally am grateful for. But this question of the accents, there is something, and this is from Virginia Woolf's time, when Virginia Woolf studied Greek at home. I guess she studied with a tutor from Cambridge, and she took a class at the ladies' division of University College in London, I think. And there's a book by a woman named Prinz who talks about all of the women who studied Greek pretty much on their own from the late 19th century into the 20th century. And it is derided by classicists as a ladies' Greek, because they said, oh, we don't need all these accents. And they just did without the accents. But of course, those accents come from the great Library of Alexandria, right? Yeah. The librarians devised them.
Yeah, at least we can say, I always tell my students that we can consider ourselves lucky, because at the time of Plato, answering Greek was, I don't know how I can spell it in English, boustrophedic. I mean, it was a Britain answering Greek. It was written without space and without their critical marks. So it was like an endless sentence. Yes.
Right. They didn't even put a period at the end of a sentence. Yes. Just all, and when, at first, it went back and forth too, right?
Yes.
What is that called? As the ox plows, budra philos, something like that.
Yes.
I wanted to ask you too, since we're talking a little about barriers to learning Greek, about the alphabet. This is another thing that both of our books have, but are approached completely differently. Mm-hmm. I love the alphabet, and I was insistent that I have a chapter early on where I force the alphabet down the reader's throat. The Greek alphabet. And it was the hardest thing I ever wrote. And I had a lot of fights with my editor because he kept saying it was boring. And I kept saying, what do you mean the letter delta? How could you call that boring? But what you have done is just sum it up. And I'm going to quote from your book. The alphabet is a means of communicating a language, not the language. All it is a writing system for getting the sounds of words down on the page. But you do acknowledge that the alphabet barrier seems to cloud our view of resemblances between Greek and our own language. And I certainly found that with readers. And you know, before I knew any Greek, it made me feel stupid to see something in Greek in a book and not be able to read it. And it happened with Thoreau once when I was reading Walden. I remember flinging it across the room. But did you think of writing about the alphabet, or what was your approach to it?
But thank you. This is a very, very, very challenging question, because what you read, now it was taken from my experience as a teacher and from experience as a student. I mean, studying, being an Italian speaking and a student of Latin, it's almost impossible that a Greek word like biblio, that means books, doesn't sound like bibliotheca. But for any students, there is the cliche that ancient Greek is too difficult because it's written in another alphabet, while Latin is easier than is smooth like. But it's not like this at all. Talking about alphabet, when I learned first, I learned the alphabet, the Greek alphabet. For me, it was really a pleasure, a gift. I was so proud of myself. Writing in another, using another alphabet, I was really, really happy. Then for me now, it's really common. It's just an alphabet. It's just an alphabet. I'm sure that I would love ancient Greek, even if it would be written in the Phoenician alphabet. But getting back to my readers, in the Italian edition, the first edition of La Lingua Geniale, I'm sure that the Italian, the Greek word are not translated, and there is no alphabet, no explanation about the Greek alphabet. And this creates like, but I can't say a polemic, but we can say the 50% of the readers, they just took the alphabet like some signs, like these are signs like me staring again at geoglyph. I can't understand, but maybe they are pretty or they look like exotic. But the other, on the other side, I received, I don't know, thousands of letters from readers saying, please explain that alphabet. But I'm sure that in the foreign edition or even in the pocket Italian edition, now there is a little Greek alphabet, but there's nothing special to explain about the alphabet. I'm sure, as you said, that if we are curious enough, really takes one day, less than one day, few hours to learn Greek alphabet.
Yes. Yes, I agree. We learned an alphabet when we were children. Yes. And you know, I would say, maybe just to keep things from getting confusing, I'd allow 2 weeks for the alphabet, but I guess what confuses people most is the letters that have that look the same, in that look like an English letter. The rho looks like P, but it's actually the R. And I think it actually makes readers a little angry.
Yes, I'm still angry. I'm often angry with ancient Greek, so I can understand.
But I was envious that you got to quote big chunks of ancient Greek in your book. My editor, we had big fights about this. Every word of ancient Greek I had to beg for, because he thought it would make the readers, you know, American readers, American film goers don't like movies with subtitles. You know, they're very proud to not have to learn another language because we can travel thousands of miles and speak our own lingua franca.
But do you know why now I can share with you, this is a safe place, why there are parts in ancient Greek? Because my editor was not convinced at all that my book will have readers. So for him, it was almost the same. Yes, let's go with ancient Greek because no one will read this book. Because no one was expecting to sell even one copy. So it was a really, do whatever you want, Andrea. Yes.
Well, that's a wonderful publishing story. We could talk a little, I think this leads to the evolution of the language. And people have asked me, well, how is modern Greek different from ancient Greek and how did it develop? And I say, I'm not a historian of the language. I can tell you a little bit about which words have developed different ways. But you have a whole chapter on the history of ancient Greek. And maybe you could talk about that from classics, from the Attic version up through Koine and onward.
Yes, for me this is one of the most interesting part of the story. I mean the evolution of languages, because as Italian speaker and as I studied Latin, they always ask me the same about the relationship between Italian and Latin or Latin languages to ancient Latin. But the story of the evolution of ancient Greek is quite interesting because it's not that common at all in all in linguistic, because Greek, now we say of course ancient Greek and modern Greek, but actually the nature of the language has not changed till the time of Plato. Till today, it's not like Latin that we can to say that Latin is a dead language that then evolved and gave birth to different languages. Of course, French and Italian are not like it's not like an uploaded version of Latin. Greek, we can say, why not? I mean, yes, we have, maybe this is important to say, we always talk about ancient Greek, but the ancient Greek we studied at high school or at university or even later, it's not like, it's only the ancient Greek was spoken in Athens in a very limited period of time, that it was the century before Jesus Christ. So it's not all the ancient Greek, it's not, it's just a very limited ancient Greek, a very limited dialect spoken in a very limited territory in a very limited time. That's because ancient, I don't want to talk for hours, but that's because, because ancient Greek was a, it was not a, a political state. It was, we can say, a federation, but it was a cultural state. It was not a political, there was not a Greek flag. The Greek flag was the Greek languages for ancient Greek speakers. That then they were, they belonged to Athens, like Sparta, like all the other polis. This was the 5th century before Jesus Christ, and as languages changed very, very fast when the political situation changed, the end of ancient Greek, as we know, ancient Greek languages, was the empire of Alexander the Great. That, first of all, destroy all the democracies, all the desire of democracy, and decided to use ancient Greek like the common languages for a, an economical empire. So at that time, and that language is the Koine, the common language. But at that time, so ancient Greek, that it was its power and its beauty, is my opinion, came from, because ancient Greek was, first of all, a cultural state, not a political state, with Alexander the Great, it was the opposite. Ancient Greek language became the common language for an economical and political state. Mm-hmm. And it's exactly at that time that ancient Greek started losing all for me, its beauty, the most fascinating part of his grammar, dual aspect, optative. Mm-hmm. And started from that period till 2 or 3 centuries ago, ancient Greek that was struggling to get modern, that's the problem of Greek language, hasn't changed that much.
Yes, you say a wonderful thing about Greek being a language that has never evolved into anything but itself.
Yes.
While Latin, of course, evolved into Italian and French and Portuguese and Italian. I wonder, because we don't have all that much time to talk, we should get to the flower of ancient Greek, which is the literature. Mm-hmm. This is why we still read it, because classics are classics because they're good.
I
wonder how, what some of my favorite things are, the tragedies and the epics. There is so much, but in Homer, we call that the ancient Greeks treated Homer as their Bible. All the situations that arise in the Iliad and the Odyssey are ways that we can read and learn how to help us cope with things that happen in our modern lives. And I wonder if you have, as I do with mythology, I have a great fondness for the Greek gods, because they are so flawed and because there's so much to learn from them. But do you have a patron god or goddess?
Hmm. Of course I have, and that goddess is Athena.
Athena,
the god of Athens. For me, it's so fascinating and so modern for that time. I mean, Athens was the biggest and the most important city of Greece, and they choose like a goddess, not a woman, of course, and a single woman. I mean, Athena is not the little prince and waiting for a prince to come and to save her. It's not the wife or someone. Of course, she's the daughter of Zeus, but almost every god was the daughter or the son of Zeus. And Athena is a warrior, but his power is her knowledge. Her symbol is the little owl. And so his strength is due to knowledge. And I'm really admire this symbol.
Once you start thinking about Athena, she has so many aspects. You know, the knowledge, of course, and knowledge of books, I guess, but also knowledge of what to do with an olive tree and how to weave. Very practical knowledge. And also, of course, she had great strength, the very feminine strength, and didn't take any nonsense. And although she was a goddess of war, she would try diplomacy first, yes. I think. And she solved more problems that way.
Yes.
So what, you know, another thing that we could talk about is to go back. Well, we could talk a little about translation. Have you ever attempted to write a translation of your own of anything from the ancient Greek?
Yes, I had. Yes. There were a few adaptations for theater and dialogue. Yes.
Because it's such a controversial thing, you know. I mean, you may, of course, we would all love our own translations. But I read very early in my research for my book about Greek that the only one who can criticize a translation is a scholar who knows the language well enough to make a judgment about it. And that kind of shut me up for a long time. And then I decided, well, I can still have preferences, can't I? So I have certain translations of Homer that I prefer, and also of the plays. I'm more in favor, I confess, of free translation than of literal translation. I think you should recreate the work in your own language to make it for the full effect. You have also written about etymology. Mm-hmm. And maybe one of the things that we could leave people with are the many, 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 many words in English, and no doubt also in Italian, that come from Greek. They came through Latin, and Latin, I think, to English through French and the Normans. But it's still, Greek is like an umbrella over all the languages of Europe, because you know the Germans use it to make up words too. But what are some of your favorite examples? I mean, I can come, alphabet is obviously a Greek word. Pandemic is clearly Greek, and that's timely. All the people, as opposed to epidemic, which is just upon the people.
Yes, but I'm used to say that everyone, I mean, in Europe and in the US, definitely speaks ancient Greek without knowing.
Yes.
But referring to Italian and French, a scholar studied and calculated that at least the 8% of words in Italian and French come directly or indirectly from ancient Greek. So it's incredible. It's like the one part, one of the 10th part of our language is Greek. And so that's why I'm sometimes when I want to be provocatory, I always say, but ancient Greek is not a dead language, it's still alive because we are still talking, speaking, but especially we are still thinking in ancient Greek. And not just because we are thinking in the same languages of Plato, but referring to literature, to mythology, to etymology, that way to figure the word out is still alive and so necessary, so needed today. And getting back to word, I really love the word harmony.
Harmony.
Yes. come from more. Yes, and now I'm not, I'm start thinking.
She, was that one of the muses, was Harmonia?
Yes, yes. She was the one who fall in love with Cadmo. It was a satyr, yes. And but Harmonia, it shared the same root with the word arithmetic.
Arithmetic?
Yes.
Oh.
Because Harmonia, it's something very concrete. I really appreciate and loved what you said about Athena, because knowledge now we have, especially in Europe, in a romantic idea like the artist or the is someone who, I don't know, look at the sky and the ideas are coming by itself. But in ancient Greek, knowledge was really, really practical. So harmony, it's not something magic that arrives with the sun, but yeah, something to build. That's why she share, the world share the same root with arithmetic, that it's really, this is something very concrete.
Okay, you also used another Greek word, magic. And that to me is, you know, the Greek is just magic. And to learn to read it is to open a whole world.
Yes. And it's a very precious way to learn, or at least to understand other languages. For me, when I start studying Russian, for me it was easier, or maybe it was so hard to learning ancient Greek that then everything looks easy. I don't know, but I have some student that confirm my theory, another Greek word.
Well, I see our hosts have reappeared.
Yeah, we're following intently. That was a fantastic conversation. And I was thinking about those names. I was thinking about the muses. I love all the muses' names, like Calliope and Clio, and when you look at them, the etymology of those, and just how beautiful they are. And I agree with Mary that, you know, you do bring your own, the longer you spend with Greek, that you do become more instinctive about what things mean, and you develop a kind of guesswork, mm-hmm, that is partly from the etymology, partly from the context, but the more you know the language, it gets so much easier to understand. And I think that's one of the great satisfactions, is that you do feel that you do feel when you get to a certain stage, you realize it's like a breakthrough. Mm-hmm. You understand how the syntax works, and it's so satisfying, you know, intellectually, but also I think emotionally as well, that it's so expressive. So I think you've both touched on that really well. And I'm just laughing at your editor, Andrea. What a terrible misjudgment to think that nobody would read the book. That's hilarious.
Now he changed his mind, but
I'd say so.
Great editor. He's a great editor. But no one was interested in ancient Greek. I mean, when I decided to study classic at university, my father, my friend told me, you are crazy. Why? What's wrong with you? Why don't you are going to study informatics, that you have to do this? Yes.
Yes, it was always a conversation stopper if you're getting your hair cut. It was like, I used to stop mentioning ancient Greek and just say history. And they'd say, oh, you're going to be a teacher. Yes, yes, that's fine. And ancient Greek just stopped everyone in their tracks. So I wanted to ask on the subject of your book being such a bestseller, and both your books are bestsellers, but Andrea's being translated into so many other languages. What you have learned from readers in other parts of the world, you touch on that a little in the book about South and Latin American readers, and yes, you know, coming to an discovering ancient Greek through your book.
Yes, thank you for this question. Actually, yes, I mean, I was so surprised. My editor, you can can figure out how much surprised was my editor with all this translation, especially talking about, especially in countries not related with our education system. I'm thinking about Asia and South America. I was so scared, surprised, worried the first time I flew to South America. It was the first time I was in Chile, Peru, to go to give conference about ancient Greek, because I was thinking, I was scared, I was thinking what these readers are going to ask me. But this was one of the most important and precious experience I had in my life, because I'm used to say that not European readers gave me ancient Greek and classic back. Because here in Europe, and I think it's been 2000 years, are we so focused in asking about, in asking, in talking about all the dangers related to, are we going to lose ancient Greek? Why no one is more interested in studying ancient Greek or classic, or in the opposite, ancient Greek is useless, ancient Greek and classic are just subject for teacher, that we are missing the literature, that flower that Mary was talking about. So there are these, all this noise around classic make appreciating its beauty and its strength and this power make it harder. While in South America, where there, or Asia, where there is no debate about useless or using about utility or about an academical career like a scholar, readers are so fascinated by the literature, by the mythology, by etymology, that they have a pure way to look at the classics, like my way when I read Gabriel Garcia Marquez. I don't know anything about Colombia, but I really appreciate that fairy tale atmosphere.
Yeah, that's really interesting. So we have put all these barriers in the way, you know, and that sense of maybe either that it's too difficult, or that there's a sort of awe or reverence around the place of classics that actually gets in the way of approaching it the way a child would approach it, you know, of actually discovering the literature and the mythology. You know, that's fascinating. Yeah. Renata, would you like to?
I was thinking of how many rewriting of Greek mythology you find in contemporary fiction. It's all over, and there are extremely, I mean, starting from, you know, German Christa Wolf, and arriving at, you know, winners of very important prizes now.
But it's been a really fantastic conversation, and really pleased to have you both as part of our first Classics Now weekend. We hope to have you in person. This is going out on Saturday, so afternoon. We'll have more events over this weekend, and viewers will be able to watch this conversation again. I'd like to also mention my colleagues on the steering committee of University College Dublin, Trinity College Dublin, and Maynooth University, and the Classical Association of Ireland, because we're all working together on this. And I particularly want to thank our partners, the Institute, Italian Culture Institute, and Renata. Her support has been amazing. And also Literature Ireland and Sinead McKay. So this event is a partnership between all three of us. And it's been an absolute pleasure. So I'd like to say thank you to you both. Come to Dublin in person. We'll have more events, hopefully, again, you know, next year, or even we're going to have some just standalone events, hopefully with Renata over the year as well. But it's been an absolute pleasure, and it just makes me want to go back and start reading Greek straight away. So thank you, Mary. Thank you, Andrea. Sure.
Thank you. Great honor. Thank you, and wonderful to meet you, Andrea.
Yes, pleasure. And thank you very much, and good night.